Hello children, very happy to welcome you all to this session of online English teaching class. I hope that you all have completed your assignments which was assigned in the previous classes. Children, don't forget to write the assignments in the English class work. While writing, if it is prose, write the name of the prose and its author's name. And if it is poem, write the name of the poem and its poet's name. Okay children, write. Now we are going to be looking at the first prose under unit 1, Two Gentlemen of Verona by A.J. Cronin. Two Gentlemen of Verona by A.J. Cronin. Few points about the author. A.J. Cronin, 1896 to 1981. A.J. Cronin was a Scottish novelist, dramatist and physician. A doctor by training, Cronin was one of the most renowned storytellers of the 20th century. Many of his short stories have emerged from his medical career and are noted for their narrative skill, deep social conscience, and finely drawn characters. Cronin's books were not only bestsellers, but some of them were made into successful films and were adapted for radio and television. His novella, Country Doctor, was adapted for a long-running BBC radio and TV series. Children, now let's learn the story, Two Gentlemen of Verona by A.J. Cronin. Two Gentlemen of Verona by A.J. Cronin. It describes the responsible and mature behavior of two young brothers who toil day and night to pay for the treatment of their elder sister, a war victim who suffers from a critical disease. Also, it is a story about love, devotion, sacrifice, sincerity, and maturity displayed by two little boys in their actions to save the life of their sister. Children, let me read the paragraphs first, followed by the explanation. As we drove through the foothills of the Alps, two small boys stopped us on the outskirts of Verona. They were selling wild strawberries. "Don't buy," warned Luigi, a cautious driver. "You will get much better fruit in Verona. Besides, these boys," he shrugged his shoulders to convey his disapproval of their shabby appearance. One boy had on a worn jersey and cut-off khaki pants, the other a shortened army tunic gathered in loose folds about his skinny frame. Yet, gazing at the two little figures with their brown skins, tangled hair and dark, earnest eyes, we felt ourselves strangely attracted. My companion spoke to the boys, discovered that they were brothers. Nicola, the elder, was 13. Jacopo, who barely came to the door handle of the car, was nearly 12. We bought their biggest basket and then set off toward town. Children, in these paragraphs, shrug means raise one's shoulders. Tunic means a loose outer garments. Children, as we all know, Verona is in Italy. The story begins with the narrator driving through the foothills of the Alps along with his companion. While driving on the outskirts of Verona, two young boys who sell wild strawberries stop their car. The small boys appear to be quite shabby, and the driver, Luigi, is not keen on buying strawberries from them. They have a shabby appearance. One boy is wearing an old damaged jersey and cut-off khaki pants. The other boy is slim and was wearing a shortened army tunic gathered in loose fold. Both of them have uncombed hair and brown skin. Then the narrator's companion gets to know that the boys are brothers. The elder one, aged 13, is Nicola, and the younger brother, aged 12, is Jacopo. The narrator and his companion buy the biggest basket of strawberries from the boys and go towards the city. In short, children, the narrator and his companion drive through the foothills of Alps. On the outskirts of Verona, they meet two shabby-looking brothers, Nicola and Jacopo, aged 13 and 12 respectively. They sell wild strawberries. Narrator and companion buy a big basket of strawberries. Children, let's move on to the following paragraphs. Next morning, coming out of a hotel, we saw our friends bent over shoe-shined boxes beside the fountain in the public square doing brisk business. We watched for a few moments, then as trade slackened, we went over. They greeted us with friendly faces. "I thought you picked fruit for a living," I said. "We do many things, sir," Nicola answered seriously. He glanced at us hopefully. "Often we show visitors through the town to Juliet's tomb and other places of interest." "All right," I smiled. "You take us along." Here, children, slackened means reduced. Here, the next morning, the narrator and his companion are surprised to see the same two boys again doing the shoe shining job beside the fountain in public square, because he thought they sell fruits only for a living. The day before, the narrator had bought strawberries from them, and on being asked, they say that they do many things for a living. They also tell the narrator and his companion that they could work as guides and show the visitors places of interest in the town. So, in short, children, through these paragraphs, we come to know that the boys are found doing jobs like polishing shoes, guiding visitors, etc. So, the narrator asks Niccolo and Jacopo to take them to Juliet's tomb. Let me read the next paragraph, children. "As we made the rounds, my interest was again provoked by their remarkable demeanor. They were childish enough and in many ways quite artless. Jacopo was lively as a squirrel. Nicola's smile was steady and engaging. Yet, in both these boyish faces, there was a seriousness which was far beyond their years. In the week which followed, we saw them frequently, for they proved extremely useful to us. If we wanted a pack of American cigarettes or seats for the opera or the name of good restaurant, Nicola and Jacopo could be relied upon to satisfy our needs. What struck one most was their willingness to work. During these summer days, under the hot sun, they shined shoes, sold fruit, hawked newspapers, conducted tourists round the town, and ran errands." Now, children, here Jacopo is described as a squirrel. Jacopo is lively as a squirrel. Nicola's smile is steady and engaging. Yet, their faces have a seriousness which is far beyond their years. Yet their faces have a seriousness which is far beyond their years. They also help the author with buying American cigarettes, booking seats for music shows, or knowing the names of the hotels. During the summer days, under the hot sun, they shined shoes, sold fruits, hawked newspapers, conducted tourists round the town, and ran errands. So, children, in this way, during the time of their stay in the town, the two boys turn out to be very helpful to the visitors. So, children, in this paragraph, demeanor means appearance and behavior. Artless means innocent. Hawk means sell things crying out loudly. Children, let me read the following paragraph, children. "One night, we came upon them in the windy and deserted square, resting on the stone pavement beneath the lights. Nicola sat upright, tired. A bundle of unsold newspapers lay at his feet. Jacopo, his head resting upon his brother's shoulder, was asleep. It was nearly midnight. 'Why are you out so late, Nicola?' 'Waiting for the last bus from Padua. We shall sell all our papers when it comes in.' 'Must you work so hard? You both look rather tired.' 'We are not complaining, sir.'" Here we can see the boys are waiting for the last bus from Padua, and so they were in deserted square at midnight. They want to sell all their unsold newspapers to the travelers in the bus. Really, they exhibit the character of hard working and they had self-determination. Children, the narrator asked the boy, "Must you work so hard? You both look rather tired." But the boy replies, "We are not complaining, sir." Here, the boy's reply shows that they are working hard because of their own will. It is not forced upon them. So these lines reveals that the boys are brave, courageous, and have a strong willpower to face the challenge. They do not feel sad. They are not dejected. It indicates that they took every challenge in life confidently. Let's move on to the following paragraphs, children. "But next morning, when I went over to the fountain to have my shoes shined, I said, 'Nicola, the way you and Jacopo work, you must earn quite a bit. You spend nothing on clothes. You eat little enough. When I see you have a meal, it's usually black bread and figs. Tell me, what do you do with your money?'" He colored deeply under his sunburn and then grew pale. He looked to the ground. "You must be saving up to emigrate to America," I suggested. He looked at me sideways, spoke with an effort. "We should greatly like to go to the States, but here at present we have other plans." "What plans?" He smiled uncomfortably. "Just plans, sir," he answered in a low voice. Here, children, emigrate means take up citizenship of another country. The next morning, the narrator talks to them and asks them why they are working so hard. He told them that they seem to fetch sufficient money, but why they were not spending anything on clothes and food. They just eat black bread and figs for food and sleep in the open street corners. Nicola tells him that they had something in their minds, but he does not elaborate. They have other plans. Children, in short, we can say the boys do not disclose their problems to the narrator. They do not expect sympathy and help from anyone. The boys are hardworking and determined to fight their own battle of life. They do not want to feel weak and so do not disclose their problem to anyone. Let me read the following paragraph, children. "Well," I said, "we are leaving on Monday. Is there anything I can do for you before we go?" Nicola shook his head, but suddenly Jacopo said, "Sir," he burst out, "every Sunday we make a visit to the country, to Polita, 30 kilometers from here. Usually we hire bicycles, but tomorrow, since you are so kind, you might send us in your car." I had already told Lugi he might have the Sunday off. However, I answered, "I'll drive you out myself." There was a pause. Nicola was glaring at his younger brother in vexation. "We could not think of troubling you, sir." "It won't be any trouble." He bit his lip. Then, in a rather put out tone, he said, "Very well." Vexation means annoyance. Here, children, Jacopo then requests the narrator to drop them in his car to the village Polita, that is around 30 kilometers away. Usually they hire bicycles. He requests him and says that it would be a great favor. Although Nicola does not like the fact that his brother is troubling the narrator gladly agrees to help the boys to reach that place, Polita, their village, 30 kilometers away. Children, now let me summarize the key points so that you can understand the first half of the story well. Right. The narrator and his companion drive through the foothills of Alps. On the outskirts of Verona, they meet two shabby-looking brothers, Nicola and Jacopo, aged 13 and 12 respectively. They sell wild strawberries. Narrator and companion buy a big basket of strawberries. The boys are found doing jobs like polishing shoes, guiding visitors, etc. During the time of their stay in the town, the two boys turn out to be very helpful to the visitors. They want to sell all their unsold newspapers to the travelers in the bus. As they sell newspapers, the narrator comes to know that they do not spend on clothes and food. Jacopo requests the narrator to drop them at Polita, their village 30 kilometers away. Children, let's revise few meanings from the glossary also. Shrug means raise one's shoulders. Tunic means a loose outer garments. Slackened means reduced. Demeanor, appearance and behavior. Artless, innocent. Hawk, sell things crying out loudly. Deserted, uninhabited. Emigrate, take up citizenship of another country. Vexation, annoyance. Now children, based on your understanding of the first half of the story, here are few questions for you. Let's try these children. First question, where did the narrator drive through? He drove through the foothills of the Alps. What did the narrator buy from the two boys? The narrator bought the biggest basket of strawberries from the two boys. Who did the narrator meet at the outskirts of Verona? The narrator met two brothers, Niccolo and Jacopo, at the outskirts of Verona. Where did the boys undertake the shoe shine work? They undertook the shoe shine work beside the fountain in the public square. Why did the driver not approve of the narrator buying fruits from the boys? The boys looked very shabby and the driver thought that the fruits might not be neat and clean, so the driver did not approve of the narrator buying fruits from the boys. Did the boys spend much on clothes and food? Though the boys earned enough money, they did not spend money on clothes and food. Were the boys saving money to go to the States? The boys did not have any idea of going to the States. How did the narrator and others get attracted towards the boys? The boys were childish and innocent. Nicola had an attractive smile. In the faces of those boys, there was seriousness which was far beyond their years. Then the last question, why did the boys rest in the windy and deserted square? The boys rested in the windy and deserted square, waiting for the last bus to come from Padua. They had a bundle of newspapers which they would sell to the passengers of the last bus. Alright children, let's revise few vocabulary exercises which you learnt in your high secondary first year. Unit 1, vocabulary. Homophones and confusibles. Homophones and confusibles. You have already learnt that homophones are words that sound alike but are different in spelling and meaning. Example, feet and feet, face and face. You have to see the spelling, children. Then next, confusibles. Confusibles are words that are commonly confused with one another in meaning or usage because of slight similarities in spelling, pronunciation or meaning. Example, moment, movement, accept, expect. Now few sentences for your reference. Fill in the blanks with suitable homophones. The farmer was ready to pour the pesticide through a pore. The mayor has a strong mare in his home. There is a stationery shop in the stationery boat in the harbor. Next children, few phrasal verbs and its meaning. Cut off means to remove something by cutting. Example, the branch was cut off from the main tree. Put out means stop something from burning. Example, the firefighters put out the fire. Come upon means meet someone by chance. I came upon an old friend in the street today. Also, few derivatives by adding prefixes and suffixes. Root word, patient. By adding prefix, impatient, suffix, patiently. Honor, dishonor, honorable. Respect, disrespect, respectable. Children, I hope that you have understood the portions taught. in this session. We'll continue the second half of this story in our next class. Children, in the meantime, read the first half of the lesson once from the text and revise the glossary, few question and answers, and the vocabulary exercises taught. Stay safe, children. Thank you.